gospel since March. Weekdays, yes, we hear the parables, but on a Sunday, no. You know that there are 32 Sundays after Pentecost. This is the greatest period of the church here, as it were. The last 10 Sundays have been Sundays without miracles. The last 7 Sundays particularly, you heard miracle after miracle after miracle. Now on the 11th Sunday, we hear about a parable. And in the forthcoming Sundays, we'll hear more about parables. And there'll be 6 more weeks before we hear about another miracle. This time of the Pentecost, the 32 Sundays, it's the missionary activity of the church, that the church, inspired by the Holy Spirit on the divine Pentecost, the apostles go out and they preach and they teach. And they confirm the teaching by miracles. 2 Sundays ago, we talked about miracles and the signs and wonders, the deeds of our Lord that advanced his kingdom. This kingdom is advanced by word and by deed. The deed is the miracles and wonders and signs. The word is his teachings. Of the 17 Sundays after Pentecost, 17 deal with miracles and 15 deal with teachings, direct teachings of our Lord. And of the direct teachings of the Lord, half of them are parables. Our Lord spoke in parables. Matthew, in his gospel, says this. He says, "For all these things Jesus taught in parables. And without parables, he taught the people nothing." Well, Matthew might be exaggerating a little because our Lord did speak directly to the people without using parables. But most of the teaching that our Lord did in his Galilean ministry of 3 years, it was in parables. Parables, they're stories. We know these stories. We're so familiar with them. The Good Samaritan, the prodigal son, the goats and the sheep, the lost coin, the sower and the seed, so many parables that we have and we know and we're familiar with. These are stories that talk about material things and incidents and people and places that could be real, but it illustrates a spiritual meaning to it. And our Lord mostly taught the people, the crowd, the multitude. The gospel says different things, multitude, people, the crowd. He mostly taught them in parables. And he also taught the Pharisees in parables. Why parables? The disciples, I guess, our Lord, they said, "Why do you speak in parables? Why do you speak in parables?" And our Lord quoted from the prophet Isaiah. He says, "I speak in parables because the people, they have ears, but they hear not. They have eyes, but see not. Because their heart is gross, their heart is heavy. But they're not open to hear the things of the kingdom of God. For those that want to hear with itchy ears and their eyes focused, they will be illumined and they will be inspired and they will understand the mysteries of the kingdom of God. But to those who are proud, those whose heart is so closed that they will never understand these things, and it's not right to cast the pearl before the swine." And so it was that our Lord spoke in the parables. Sometimes even the disciples didn't understand the parables. And it would say that the disciples came to him later and said, "Explain to us this parable. What was this about?" And our Lord explained the parables, but he never explained the parables to the crowds of the people or to the Pharisees. He only explained in private the parables to his disciples. He said, "It's for you important to be schooled in the parables. It's important for you to know the things of the kingdom of God." And so the parables, and many of the parables, they're parables of what we call of the kingdom. There's 30 parables that are recorded in the gospel. There's probably many more, just as there are many more miracles that are recorded that are not recorded in the gospel. But most of these are beginning, the kingdom of God is like this, and the kingdom of God is like that. And then there are other parables that don't have the kingdom of God is like, but there are parables that are direct, as it were, judgment of those that hear them. And so we have the parables. Today's parable is a parable of the unforgiving servant. This parable is clear what it says to us. So hopefully it's clear. The last line of the parable, it says everything. "If you do not forgive men your their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive." It's about forgiveness. The story is, of course, one man, he owns millions, the scriptures say 10,000 talents. The other coin owes a trifling amount, 100 pence. Well, translated, that would be millions versus a couple hundred dollars if you want. And so there's a great disparity here between the two servants. And the meaning, of course, is that the one who owed the money, to whom it was owed, he forgave the servant. All these millions, this rich amount that he had, he had pity on the man, he had compassion upon the man, and he forgave him. And that man, in turn, should have, of course, forgiven others, extended the generosity he received, and extended to others, but he didn't. And to the poor guy that owed him just a little, he was harsh and had him thrown in the prison. The meaning of the gospel is clear to us. The prayer, the Lord's Prayer, we have, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And you probably heard the English translations, which is more in tune with the Greek. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. So trespasses, transgressions, debts, debtors. That is the same thing that is given to us here. We're called to forgive as God has forgiven us. That we have been indebted to God. We've been indebted to our Lord Jesus Christ. That he is the one in his great generosity has forgiven our debt. Well, how are we indebted to God? Well, just on one thing. And the one thing is our sinfulness. That we have no part of the kingdom of God. That we couldn't be called children of God. That we were destined to die, not to taste of immortality, to be removed from God for all eternity. Why? Because of sin. Is any of us here not a sinner? Of course we're sinners. And that debt was paid by our Lord on the cross, by his blood. He washed away our sins. He washed away the debt of our sins. And so we are free. We are free of the debt. But the kingdom of God has been opened to us. That we've been restored to be called children of the day, children of the light, sons of God, co-inheritors with Jesus Christ. And not only was the debt forgiven, but we were exalted. So that everything that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Son of Man, is by nature, we are called to partake and to be by grace. In other words, what Jesus has, we have. Who Jesus is, he shares that with us. That we are those of the royal household of God, that we belong to him, that he is our Abba, our Father, and we are his children, that we are members of his family. And so for us, the primordial lesson of the gospel, of the new law, is to forgive. It's foundational, but it's one of the most hardest things for us to do, because we bear resentment. We say that it's an injustice. Why should I forgive? What's in it for me that is owed, that we think of terms of an ethics that has nothing to do with the ethics of the kingdom of God? What determines forgiveness is our knowledge and experience and our thanksgiving to God for all that he's done for us, and to experience his love, and to extend that love to others. If God forgives us, we should forgive others. We might say, well, I don't have the heart to do it. Well, make it in your heart. If your heart was in Jesus Christ, you could forgive. If you really love God, you would love your neighbor. If you really want to be with God, then you would extend that relationship to the neighbor. You can't have a good relationship with God. You can't have a love for God without a love for the neighbor at the same time. And the neighbor is anyone. And it's everyone. Those that are near, those that are far. Those who are indebted to us and those who are not indebted to us. And even to our enemy, the gospel is clear on that. Love your enemy. Do good to those who persecute you. If they slap you on the one cheek, turn the other cheek. If they ask you to go a mile, go 2 miles. If they ask for something for you to wear, give them your tunic. That this is the expression of extending love and generosity and thanksgiving to God for everything that we received. We don't want to be those that are gross of heart, those of hearts that are enclosed, those whose hearts and minds are of this fallen world and see everything in terms of justice, of what is due, of what is owed me. We don't do that. We can't do that. It's not befitting of us as children of God. The Apostle Paul in Colossians, he says, forbear with one another and forgive one another. If anyone has a quarrel against you, as Christ has forgiven you, so also do you extend that forgiveness to the other. Indebtedness, trespasses, you might say, well, I don't owe anybody money, no. But there are other things, other resentments that we harbor, other things that we're not willing to forgive, other slights that we have. Somebody stepped on our toes, figuratively, as it were, or maybe literally. That we were offended, that we're not going to forget, where we say, I'll forgive, but not forget. Well, this idea of forgiving and not forgetting, do you want the Lord to remember that about us, about our sins? When our sins are forgiven, they're forgotten. They're erased from the book of life. If we make a pure confession of our sins, those sins aren't there. They've evaporated. They're not in the book of life. When the book of life is open on the day of judgment, it's not there. There's no double jeopardy because we confessed and that debt is taken away by the love of God that has for us. In this world, there's very little forgiveness. We define people as enemies. We define people as the opposition. We define those that we want nothing to do with, that they're unworthy of everything. And yet, for our real understanding of what it is to live in this fallen world, we have to be those that are anchored in Christ Jesus. We have to know his love. We have to experience his generosity. We have to be thankful for his taking away all the debts that we have, so that we're free people, that we owe nothing. And in thanksgiving for that, what do we do? Well, we keep the two great commandments. Love the Lord our God with our whole heart, our soul, our whole mind, our whole strength, and to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. So let us be those that hearken to this particular parable, the parable of forgiveness, and be merciful, be generous, be kind to one another, as our God himself has been kind and generous and loving to us. Amen.